Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen. Several years ago, I went on vacation and had a neighbor friend house sit and take care of my dog. When I returned, it was clear that she had gone through my things and some of my items, my possessions, were missing. It was an awful way to come home from a vacation, feeling like I had been violated and betrayed by someone I thought I could trust. When I confronted her about it, she lied at first, but then confessed to a drug problem and tried to make up for the things that had gone missing. There was a lot more, obviously, to this story that goes deeper than just stolen or missing items. But the bottom line was that trust was betrayed. I felt that I had been personally violated, and I didn't feel entirely safe in my own home for several weeks. And I had also lost a friendship. It was never really the same as it had been before. So I'm sure that many of us have stories like this where someone has taken something from us, whether possessions or even a sense of dignity or security. This commandment, do not steal, falls in line with the commandments that come before and after it. Each one has to do with the way that we treat other people and those closest to us, our parents, our spouse, or our neighbors. This particular lesson is usually something we try to instill in our children from a young age. I watch this side of human nature come alive as my son is learning to play with other children. His instinct, especially when he was very young, was to take something that he wanted, even though someone else was playing with it, especially if someone else was playing with it. Just because someone else had it made him want it even more. The grass is always greener on the other side, as they say. We are still working on understanding what belongs to him and what belongs to someone else. And if it's something we want, there is an opportunity to ask politely to see it or to borrow it. And sometimes I feel like this is a life lesson for all of us. At the heart of this commandment is the idea that theft is an affront to the personhood and rights of another. According to early rabbinical interpretation of this commandment, it's the stealing of people that is at the heart of it. Kidnapping people and selling them into slavery, as was done to Africans and others throughout history, is forbidden by this commandment. We also know that, unfortunately, there are other texts in the Bible that appear to condone slavery. However, the very next chapter of the Torah says that any person who kidnaps another, especially when done with the intention of selling the person into slavery, shall be put to death. As most of us know, the Bible is full of gray areas on these topics. We still see tragic situations of human trafficking and people being sold into slavery still in our world today. We also see people every day who have their dignity stolen or their reputation wrongly put into question. And of course, greed and oftentimes need is at the center of stolen property and possession. For those who first heard this commandment, it was possibly about not stealing human beings for slavery or kidnapping, but it was also a warning about stolen goods. For many of the Israelite people, property was their only means of livelihood. Their animals, their home, their tools for work. If anything was stolen by someone else, their livelihood could be put at stake, and harm is perpetuated in this action. It never makes anything or anyone better in the long run. More than anything else, this commandment speaks to the widespread corruption that makes it impossible for any society to progress politically, morally, or economically. As human beings, we have a tendency to manipulate life to our advantage, which might include taking something that does not belong to us, or taking advantage of a person or situation. Stealing can be active or passive. It's not just taking from others what is theirs, but withholding from others what we ought to give. Could it be that our most blatant act of stealing is withholding care and concern for those around us? Or is stealing a sin because it betrays our trust in a God of grace and generosity? How can we be part of a change in our culture that is so widespread with corruption, greed, and theft, into a culture then of generosity and abundance? I believe it begins with seeing the sacred worth of every human being. If this commandment at its center is speaking against the stealing of dignity and personhood of another, then we begin with this valuable lesson. During the apartheid regime in South Africa years ago, the corrupted government rationalized a system of oppression for blacks and persons of color. The dignity of these persons was stolen. Violence, exile, and humiliation occurred as a result, and the effects are still seen and felt today in South Africa. Archbishop Desmond Tutu made it his mission to begin a process of healing as the system finally began to break down. His work with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission invited people to come and share their stories. Sometimes they were extremely difficult to share and to hear, but he invited them to share the stories with one another so that one's personhood was on full display as a reminder that we are all, at the end of the day, human beings. He talks about the African word Ubuntu. It speaks of the very essence of being human. It is to say, my humanity is caught up, inextricably bound up in yours. We belong in a bundle of life. A person with Ubuntu, Tutu says, is open and available to others, affirming of others, and is diminished when others are humiliated or diminished, when others are tortured or oppressed or treated as if they were less than who they are. If we are able to practice Ubuntu, we are capable of abiding by this commandment. We are able to restore personhood and dignity to others instead of diminishing or stealing their humanity, or labeling them as less than, or simply different than we are. Do not steal is a reminder to treat others as you would like to be treated. This includes personhood, possessions, and the way of life of others. In doing this, we honor a generous God in the way that we practice generosity to others. So may this be a reminder and a challenge for each of us as we continue in a world that is so bound up by our love of things and our tendency to take what is not ours for the taking. Amen.